waiting for. Without further ado, we're very happy to welcome Jelmer Koekoek from Dutch Online Knapbank onto the stage. Jelmer, the floor is yours.
Yes, I am, and also my content. That's nice. It's an honor to be the first talk on what I hope is the first of many Obeya summits to come in the next few years. And I'm very happy that I can share my story with you today. I'm going to make sure that... I think some settings are correct. First of all, I'm happy because I really believe that OKRs and Obeya make for a very good marriage. There's a lot of synergy between the two concepts, and there's hardly any what you call integration issues. The concepts just really work well together, and I hope that I can show you at least how we combine them, and that's an inspiration to you. The second reason I am glad is this. It's the fact that I'm really proud that my colleagues at Knap and also the leadership team at Knap have such a growth mindset that they're willing to join me and my team on a continuous learning journey to experiment with our way of organizing ourselves. We started off with half-decent objectives and key results in a half-finished Obeya room, partly because we had to halfway the process change from a physical room to a digital room. And even today, we are nowhere near where we want to be. But we didn't wait until we were ready. We just started. And if there's one thing that I would like you to take away from this afternoon, it's that whether it is about OKRs or Obeya or any of the other tools and techniques that you will hear about today, you should just start using them. And only by using them will you learn what it is you need to do to actually get value out of them. So that's what my talk is going to be about today. So why should you listen to me and hopefully also believe what I say? I am Jelmer. I am an agilist or agile coach at Knap. I've been working with OKR since 2016, both in startup settings and in large companies. And I found myself for the first time in an Obeya room in 2017. This was at ING. And for me, it's not a big surprise to see so many Obeya lovers from ING today in the call. So that's good. That's good to see that you are still loving the concept. Since December 2018, I work at Knap. And at Knap, we have been continuously learning and experimenting with our way of working since its foundation in 2012. In 2019, we started implementing objectives and key results to improve the way we set priorities and how we make decisions. In April 2020, we started to incorporate that in an Obeya room to visualize our goals, our performance, and our work. Well, this hardly makes us experts on Obeya, right? So I'm really happy that Tim is going to be here today to explain you much more about Obeya and compensate for my lack of expertise. But it does mean that we have a track record of 4 years of learning and experimenting with ways to create transparency on the process that turns strategy into execution. And that's what I will talk about next. So, a little bit of content. I will speak first a little bit about the context of Knap, because it helps you understand why OKRs and Obeya works for us. Then I'll dive a little bit into objectives and key results itself. I'll explain how we run things at Knap, how our walls looks like, how our events happen, what we talk about. And I'll share our plans for the future and the challenges that we face. And I hope we have plenty of time for Q&A. We will not be able to replicate the interaction that we would have in a live setting. But I'm asking you to make an effort together with me to get very close to that. Because I'm really curious for your opinions, your questions. It will make the talk more valuable and also more fun. And if not for you, then at least for me. So please help me make this interaction as interactive as possible. And we're going to do that by using Mentimeter as a tool for questions and answers and remarks. And you can use that in a number of ways. You go to menti.com Use the code that is on this slide and will be on all the slides following. You can scan the QR code you see on your screen right now with your phone. And what's going to happen is I brought a charming assistant, my colleague Patrick. Patrick, let's see if we can also hear you. Hey, yes. Great. And Patrick will help me monitoring the Q&A. And one way you can help us is if you see a question that you like, and you also would see answered, give it a thumbs up. That helps us. What we're going to try is if the questions really integrate well into the story, we're going to address them right away. Otherwise, we're going to keep them for the end. And the chat of Zoom will only use it if you have no access to the tool Mentimeter or you have technical issues during the meeting. Well, let's try this out straight away. But before that, one final request. It's scary enough to talk to your screen to 300 people, but seeing only black holes would make it a whole lot harder and scary. So it's really encouraged to keep your video on during the event because it turns my black hole, what I'm looking at, into something that I can see, whether you laugh at my jokes or not falling asleep. That's the minimum viable result here. All right. So if you please go to menti.com and do it right now, because I'm going to start with a question for you. Patrick, could you take over screen sharing and show the Menti?
And I already shared the link for people who are not using it yet, but it is being used a lot. Yes. So I will share it because, let me see. Can you see my screen?
Yes, we can. All right.
So a lot is going on.
Be specific as possible, guys, because OKR and Obeya is really going to be there. Don't be afraid. So just experiences, inspiration. Let's hope so. Well, at least we can see that 50 of you now found the tool. But I'm aiming for like all the participants in the room. So please use it because I'm going to have some questions for you. And this is your way to ask questions to me. All right. Well, Patrick, let's keep an eye on this thing. I will resume the presentation. Okay. Also. And you'll see that every time I take over, I have to start from start. I will start with a bit of context that you might need. This man here is René Vrijters, and he's the founder of Knap. And he started Knap really with the idea as a giant experiment. He disliked banks that were present in the market at that moment. And he just decided there's enough banks that put the B of bank in the front. I'm going to found a bank with the K of customer at the front. He founded a bank and it started off as one big experiment because it was the first bank without any branches in the Netherlands. And it was also the first to introduce a new system, a new fee structure. So it started off as a very small team with very simple goals, as many clients as possible and as satisfied customers as possible. That combination gives you a lot of focus. I joked the other day to Bart and Dolph that you are actually always in your Obeya room because you can just stand up and everyone in the company is always there. All the information is present. Nowadays, Knap is a full-fledged bank with a special focus on the self-employed people and entrepreneurial-minded Dutch people in general. There's 500 colleagues. And we have over 200,000 customers. And you can already understand that that focus that we had at the start, it's very hard to maintain that when you grow from, in Dutch, I would say from a napkin to a tablecloth. To help us, guide us, we have a mission, a purpose. And our purpose is we want everyone to feel at ease when it comes to their finances every day. Knap is an, I would say, obsessively customer-focused company. I think that started off, of course, with the name, but it is really in the veins of everyone at Knap. But we try to do this in a very complex world where technology, customer demands, and even regulation is changing faster every day, and it is really hard to keep up. And in order for us to be able to fulfill our purpose, we need to learn faster. We need to accelerate the value that we deliver towards our customers and our employees. This means that we need to adapt. We need to adapt our organization structure. We need to adapt our processes, our decision-making, and how we lead the company. And that's what drives me and my team every day. It's also why we chose objectives and key results as the company's only framework to talk about goals for the business. Because we see companies that are able to learn super fast often are using OKR. Let's switch to OKRs. Because we have been looking for companies that are able to make everything small, small decisions, small teams, small work items, that are able to operate as a network of teams and not as a hierarchical organization, and that are able to keep the customers at the heart of all of those decisions. And if you look at them, many of them are using something that they call objectives and key results. And what you see here is, I think, the first objective ever set that you could call an objective with hindsight. And I'm referring to John F. Kennedy, who in 1960 said, "We're going to put a man on the moon before the end of this decade." And then he added, "And bring him back." So I think he introduced two things to the world at that point. The first one is scope creep, because that "and bring him back" was not part of the original mission. But also, this is an objective, setting a flag, well, literally here on the moon, but giving direction to something that is seemingly impossible. And it set in motion a series of events that we're benefiting from even today with, for example, a development of GPS that we now all have on our phones and watches. So it's a very powerful thing to say, we're just going to put a man on the moon. We don't know how yet, but this is the objective. I want to go back to Mentimeter and see how experienced you are with OKRs to see what I should explain. So if you see in Menti now, you get the question, how experienced are you with objectives and key results? And maybe Patrick, you can put that on the screen. Oh, sorry. Again.
Something, I believe you have it now. Yeah. You see the question.
I see the question, but we don't see the results just yet.
No. They're coming in, and I'll share. You see my screen?
Yeah, we do. And what we see is that we have a very much a mixed bag in the audience. Quite a big portion that are a big fan of three-letter abbreviations, which here indicates that we have no experience and not a lot of knowledge about OKR. So we have to take that into account. So for the people that indicated that they are the OKR masters, we might want to, it might be revisiting what you already know, but there are some flavors in there that we explicitly put in there as KNAP. So I'm hoping that that will still be an interesting addition. It's good to see that many of you do know what it is and are already using it. That's very, very cool. All right, there we go again. And I have to. All right, objectives and key results. It's not new, it's not revolutionary. It's something that was developed in the 1970s, mainly at Intel. And for a large part by the smiling guy on the left, his name is John Doerr. He developed it at Intel, and he took it with him when he was one of the early investors in Google. And Larry Page and Sergey Brin adopted it at Google very early. And when they wrote their book, Work at Google, a few years, or How Google Works, a few years ago, they very explicitly attribute part of their success as a company to their use of OKR. And if you look at where it's used, it's virtually used in all different sectors. I just put some logos here, but it is, of course, in software firms, but also at hardware companies like GE, maybe not the best example if you look at company success at the moment, but also in retail companies like Gap or GoPro. If you look at what it is, it's the combination of a qualitative aspiring goal with very, very smart key results. Will reach this objective as measured by these key results. And what's really important there is you should never split them. So never only an objective, because that is maybe very ambitious and very inspirational. But if no one knows how we're going to measure how we're going to get there, you run the risk of everyone doing something else. And if you only have really measurable goals, but no inspirational example, that doesn't really motivate me to get into a traffic jam every morning. So OKRs say always use them together. I want to reach this objective as measured by these key results. And formulating good ones is really hard. And if there's one thing that you should not do is iterate and iterate and iterate with your first draft until you're satisfied. I've tried that before and you just will never get there because it's quite hard. Good objectives need to be transformative. It's not like the same as last year, but a bit better. They should be inspiring towards your staff or towards your team or towards the entire organization. They should be easy to remember. I mean, OKRs work best and if everyone that should know what they are actually are able to just name what they are at each coffee machine or when you wake them up at night, and they're qualitative. So there's no numbers in there. And how you phrase them is entirely up to you. It should suit the culture that you have in your company. Key results, on the other hand, must have numbers, but not just any numbers. They must represent actual value. So it should never be, I want to have five proposals for innovation, because they can, all five of them can be worthless proposals. It's about what value are you trying to get out of that. And to test that, you should be able to slice them. For example, say not five, I don't want to attract 10,000 new customers, but let's say 5,000. Is it still valuable? Then probably you have a key result. And what's the catch here is you should not have too many of both of them. Because what happens if you have three objectives and three key results, this creates nine things that ask for attention and focus of the organization or your team, whatever you're setting your goals for. If, however, I have five objectives with each five key results, there's already 25 things screaming for attention. And although they might be in the correct order, with number one getting more attention than number five, history shows that having more goals will dilute the focus that you have, and that will just slow down your delivery. And with that, the speed with which you can learn. Yep, that's there.
Jammer.
Yes.
We have a few questions, but also in the word cloud, it's a lot about how to start. How do you actually start?
Well, I think the most important thing is get a first set and start using them, maybe without giving them much attention yet. Only use them at the as like a shadow system, maybe at your board or your team to see, are these the right ones? Are we able to measure what we want to measure? Is it actually the important stuff? That's how I would start. But I will get to some more of that stuff a bit later on. Let's focus a little bit on some other thing that really distinguishes OKR from other systems to set goals. Because I've been using lots of goals before that were on activity level or outputs. Just go do marketing, go and recruit new colleagues, or on outputs. Please make sure that we have 10 interviews each week. That's not what we try to do with OKR. So let's look at this example. I think it's an example I thought of with colleagues at ING actually back in the day. It's that the example of building a village well. So in order to build a well, I need to do stuff. I need to have some activities, sourcing materials, digging, building. And the output of that, so the direct result of this process, is one well. But it's the effect of doing that that's interesting. So for example, building this well might reduce the time that children have to spend on getting water from 2 hours every day to 10 minutes every day. It's what happened because we built that well. It might even be better. It might be that this increases the percentage of kids that are able to join school in that village. And that might lead to something that we inspire to change in the first place, and that is elevate the quality of life for this whole community through education. So this is really the hard part, because we try to set objectives on that impact level. We want to change the world, or we want to be the best hardware company in the Netherlands. And outcomes should always be the input for your key results. And the nice thing about that is outcomes are always the behavior of systems, of customers, of employees. And because it's behaviors, it is observable and thus also measurable. So good key results on outcome level, you should always be able to measure them. One personal example. And in Corona times, this has been a bit harder than before. My objective is to nail the half distance triathlon. And I'm measuring that. So as measured by improving my personal best on the whole distance. So that's what I call nailing it. It is making sure that I turn a 4 minute split. So my second half of my half marathon is slower than the first half, to turn that into a negative split before it's February, and increase the average power I deliver on the bike from 275 watts to 300 watts before the end of the year. You can already see this is how we formulate the key results, always from, to, before, when, and in absolute numbers if possible. And here's something that we added to objectives and key results. While focusing on these key results, I also make sure that I don't get injured and I keep my sleep quality okay and my family stays happy. The objective is an impact language. It's inspirational to me, at least. And that's important because I'm the only audience for this objective. The key results are outcomes. It's things I can observe and measure. And the things on the bottom are what we call health metrics. And health metrics are not the goal. It's not my goal not to be injured, because if that were my goal, the best thing to do is probably just sit on the couch. Health metrics are preconditions to stay successful in the long run, because if I'm continuously injured, that objective is never going to happen.
Jelmer, we have a question.
Yes.
How do you determine the scope in the OBEA? When do you know you have too many objectives?
I think when you have to conclude that you're not satisfied with the progress on them. I once worked with a team that had 20 objectives and key results. And even then, we had stuff that was not contributing to any of them. And it just meant that we are moving on 20 goals at the same time, very, very slowly. Well, because my goal is to learn faster and accelerate the value delivery of KNAP, that doesn't work for us. So there's a natural tendency to say, okay, can we do with 15 instead of 20? Can we do with 10? I think the people that wrote the book said it's ideal to have one. Well, that's really hard. But one thing you should remember is that objectives and key results don't try to cover everything we do. It's defining how we measure what is success and what does success look like. I can imagine that you say, yes, but in my organization, we have a lot of numbers that are worth measuring. Well, I work in a bank. We have all the numbers. Right? So we have a lot of numbers that are worth measuring and that are really important. But we use our health metrics exactly for that. And I'll show you how it looks like. Any more questions on this part, Patrick?
Let me see.
I see one in the chat. So that's at least there's some people that haven't found
the Mentimeter yet.
I just this morning had a conversation about OGSM, and I think that in while I'm not an expert on OGSM, especially the top part, like the objectives and the goals, are very similar. But the real difference is also partly in the nuances that we don't have time for today. But I would suggest to read one of the books I'm going to recommend you guys in a few minutes. And let's continue that conversation in the on the forums. But any tool that will help you to get to visualize and get you that focus that you need, I don't care if it's okay. It just works for us. Let me explain how we're going to do that. Before that, here are four books that I would recommend. They're all very good. When it comes to John Doerr, I suggest to aim at the first part that explains the concept, because his chapter on his examples are also like from the 70s and the 80s, and they're not the best examples of how you should do them now. I think for starters, the book by Christina Wodke is really great in explaining the basic concepts of it. Also, Felipe Castro's book to the right, The Beginner's Guide to OKR, highly recommended. Any questions on theory still, Patrick?
Well, there is something, health metrics equals KPI, somebody mentioned.
Well, the funny relationship that I have with KPIs is that there's always the K of key. But everywhere I see KPIs, I mostly see just so many of them that I'm they're performance indicators. So in that sense, yes. For us, the distinction is that we don't expect to actively work on health metrics. We expect to monitor them so we can act if they go into a red zone. It's the objectives and key results that we are actively trying to influence. So this is what we do.
Sorry, Jelmer, yeah? I have another one, but maybe it will come in the slide, but who is responsible for setting the objectives?
And yeah, let me answer that in a few minutes. So I'm going to start here. This is how we actually use them. So we start from our purpose. And based on that purpose, we start. Answer that question right now, I think. Because we start with setting objectives and key results on company level. And it's the board that does that. So they determine what success looks like for the entire company. And while that strategy has roughly a 3 to 5 year horizon, objectives and key results, the objectives often, they tend up until now to stay the same roughly a year. Key results, we reset them every quarter. And that's done by the board. I have a workshop with them next Friday, and there we're going to set them. What we also do is we set must-do projects, because sometimes it makes no sense to construct an objective and a key result for something if it's just, we just need to do this for some reason. For example, let's say we need to build a report for one of our regulators, let's say the Dutch Central Bank. I can construct a beautiful objective and key result for that, but that would leave much more room for interpretation while we just have agreed that we need to build this report. So for those circumstances, we just have a separate list of must-do projects. And our aim is to keep that list as short as possible. And we have our health metrics, and I will show you how they look like in just a few minutes. Let's speed up a little bit, because otherwise we're going to go over time. So what we then do is that teams, departments will set objectives and key results on their level. So that is the responsibility and the mandate of the of that specific value stream or department. But of course, that needs to be, there's a dialogue between the board and that department, because if everyone just works on what they think is important themselves and we don't meet, we don't achieve the objectives and key results of the company, then we're not successful as a company. Speeding up. All right, so how does this fit into an Obeya? We have four walls. We have a strategy wall where we visualize our company objectives and key results and our must-do projects. Then we have a performance wall where we display our key results and health metrics. I will show them in a minute. We have portfolio walls that display the progress on work and our projects. And they're, of course, linked to our key results. And we have an action wall where we have issues and impediments to make sure that that work actually progresses. So what's on there? What do we do then in our Obeya room? So each quarter we reset, we evaluate and set the objectives for KNAP, and subsequently all the departments or value streams will set their own objectives and key results. After that, during the quarter, each month we check in on our performance. We inspect the status of our key results and health metrics, and we have the conversation, are we going fast enough? Should we change anything? Bi-weekly, we check in on the work. Is it progressing? Are we on plan to deliver that value that should deliver those objectives and key results? If not, what should we do? Bi-weekly is a rhythm that suits the company very well because most teams are on a bi-weekly rhythm. And each week we follow up on the resolving of issues that we might face, impediments that the teams might have. So how does this look in practice? So I'm really sorry because I can't give you the actual peek into the kitchen because I'm not sharing our current objectives and key results, but I'm showing you how they look like in our virtual Obeya room. So first of all, our objectives and key results. They're in a dashboard. We use a tool, it's called Tableau. And we pull all the information, all the relevant metrics of the entire company, pull them into Tableau. And there's one page where you can immediately see on the big blocks on the left are our objectives at this point, and all the rows next to that are key results. And you can immediately see the current status of those goals. So at one glance, we know, are we in general doing well at the moment? But for each of those key results, we have a metric. And we display them in a uniform way. Every metric we display should look roughly the same. Why? Because it reduces the time to understand what I'm looking at, and that just facilitates easier decision-making and speedier decision-making. So each metric will show you what's the actual, what's the goal when it is a key result, or what's the threshold when it comes to a health metric, and is it currently green or red? And each metric has one graph that will show you what's the trend, or a bit more detail. And if you then zoom out, without actually looking at the individual results or the individual metrics, it's really easy to get an overview of how are we doing in general. And when I look at this wall, my impression would be, well, I don't know the details, but it looks that we're doing pretty well. And this is the power of visualizing your key results in an Obeya. Because if you have all these issues concentrated in this room, when we're going to make plans, what should we focus on next quarter while looking at this wall? That's just extremely powerful.
A lot of questions.
You'll stop me when we have
a lot of questions, but they're also answered by the group.
Oh, that's great. Exactly what we're here for.
Yeah, but still, does this easily match with Scrum? Lisetta asks. And
yeah, very much, because we steer on outcomes. So that makes it really easy to say to the team, this is the goal. You figure out how to adjust your backlogs. Right? Because nowhere here have I spoken about telling the teams what to do. It also facilitates really rapid inspection and adaption cycles, which is exactly what Scrum is about, when you ask me. I wanted to show you the portfolio walls, because that's where we link and make as explicit link as possible between the initiatives, projects, epics, whatever you want to call them, and the objectives. And we are aiming for a really hard link between the initiative and the key result. So if the key result is to attract 10,000 new customers, each initiative contributing to that should say, well, this is aimed at delivering 3,000 you can't reverse engineer and say, well, this is also kind of related to this objective. That's not how it works. What is also nice about this visualization is that you will get a view on how many things you are doing that are not contributing to your objectives and key results. And that will happen in any organization. But if it's half of the energy of your entire company, you have to question yourself, are we doing, do we have the wrong objectives? Or do we have the guts to make choices? I'm getting to the end because otherwise people will get angry at some point and we don't have room for more questions. A few things that we still want to do or are trying and struggling with. First of all, we talked about those must-do projects and we have the ambition to reduce that as much as possible. Because if you give a team the responsibility to deliver outcome, they will actually feel responsible, can take responsibility for that. And if you just tell them to do something, the best they can do is be very busy and do the best they can. There's a big difference there. The second thing is to translate those performance roles on all levels of the organization. And we need to balance creating transparency on all the numbers that are there, but also creating confusion because death by numbers, so many metrics. Also to include some parts of the organization processes in there. For example, how to translate our progress on our key results to how we divide our budgets, or how to incorporate objectives and key results in our review, our yearly review process. Also, we would like to see some more adaptation. It's very nice to inspect how you're doing, but are you then also able to change? Because if you're just saying, hey, there's an iceberg and we are getting towards it, but we're not course correcting, it does not really make sense. And that's hard. Partly because
we have 7 minutes and perhaps then time for a few more questions. So
sure, because there's
this is the last one, right?
Yes.
Okay. Shall we go to the questions, or do you want to?
Let me finish last one. So, making sure your team structure facilitates focus is just really hard, especially if you still have some component-driven teams instead of that might need each other all the time, or teams that are very specialized and can only work on one item. It's really hard to focus as much energy as possible at your most important objectives and key results. That is a continuous challenge for us. And what we also would like to do, what is really being strengthened by OKRs, is to work more hypothesis driven, which means that if we have no clue yet if a certain initiative is going to attract 2,000 or 10,000 new customers, let's run a small experiment to get a bit of a hunch. And let's turn that small experiment into an MVP that will prove to us that it's worth making the large investment and work on it for a bit of a longer term. All right, Patrick, so you say we have 5 minutes left. That's really good to use that for Q&A.
Yes, yes.
Let's put that on the screen as well. So I will stop sharing. You put the questions on the screen.
Well, there's a lot in the chat, to be honest.
Ah, okay. So, Tableau is rather expensive. It's worth it. Oh, well, that's an answer. Nice. Yeah, I mean, I'm really tool agnostic. There's also specialized tools that you can use to track objectives and key results. If you think it's worth it, please do. What I do believe is that, especially in this day and age, a tool like iObeya, and I'm not being paid here, but we are a very happy iObeya customer, really helps in integrating all of it. So we have Tableau. We can publish that with a bit of a workaround in iObeya. We have Jira, where all our work resides. We can pull that into iObeya. It's really worth having that kind of tooling available.
You see,
where do you address the learnings? Well, we don't have explicit a wall for that in the OBEA just yet. It's a good point. we do capture them, for example, in that quarterly, in those quarterly cycles. And I think the fact that we change and improve that, those processes every quarter, we don't have to log them. But making that more explicit could be valuable.
Which solutions are you using at Knap for visual management?
Answered now. So mainly iObeya. Yeah. I see Frederik smiling.
And let me see. To what extent is the organization involved? Does it stop at the product owner level?
No. So I think there's a difference between being involved and being able to challenge. Do we have the right goals and do we have the right key results, and ask, have the necessary information to be able to buy in? But we're not turning it into a democratic process. I believe that priority setting is a top-down activity. So the management board sets the objectives and key results for the company. Then teams in a value stream set the objectives and key results for that value stream. And then the teams itself translate that from goals to what should we then start doing? What are the outcomes that we should deliver? So in the end, the entire company is involved.
Great. Well, I think we're almost there.
How big by square meter are your visualizations? Well, that's the beauty of scaled images. I have no clue. What iObeya does is it tries to introduce real world sizing into virtual boards. So, and there it says that my boards are 4A0, but I have no clue how many meters that would be. Because, and also to answer Henry's question, we wanted to start with our iObeya start of March 2020. And 2 weeks in, we were all sent home. So, we don't have a physical iObeya at the moment. And I will see later if it's worth the effort, because I think it's a huge effort to keep a physical wall and a digital wall synced, and to not suffer from synchronization issues. So we will judge then if it's worth it, if it brings extra value to create a visual wall. And yes, Jira is directly connected to it, yeah. But I think Frederik and his colleagues are doing a talk a little bit later, and maybe they can show that as well. I'm earning points here, I see. That's nice, yeah.
And maybe the last one, Jelmer. The most painful learning.
One of the most more painful ones is that we've fallen into this trap a few times, that we said, we don't know how to measure this yet, but let's set the key result anyway, because maybe that's an incentive for us to start measuring it. And always at the end of the quarter, we have to conclude, we still can't measure it, so we have no clue. So it didn't help us at all to set direction for the company. So only the learning for us is only set objectives and key results for stuff you can actually measure. All right, let's wrap it up. I hope I have been able to show you how compatible those two concepts are, iObeya and OKR. And I also hope that I've given you a little bit of inspiration how to start and not to wait until it's perfect, because the real value is in learning. I really would like to thank Bart and Dolph for kickstarting this movement. The fact that we're already answering questions towards each other in the chat is for me already proving the value of this iObeya association. And I'm very grateful that they have started it. Let's continue the conversation on the forums on the website. And I hope you will enjoy the rest of the conference. Bye-bye.
Thanks, Jelmer. This was incredible. We've been listening very closely, and we heard some amazingly difficult questions being fired upon you, and you were able to answer them on the spot. You didn't even hesitate. The guy didn't even blink.
He didn't even stutter.
He didn't even stutter. Incredible. What a performance. Thanks so much. And what an amount of knowledge. We're so happy. And I think for all people here, this information, well, I don't think you can get this from a book. Jelmer, thanks for sharing your experiences and all of your wisdom. Great job.